there. Today we're in Lublin and we're taking 2 days to explore and find the Ashkenazi Jewish flavors of the Lubelski region. I'm Mary.
And I'm Radzio. Lublin is known as a city of many inspirations and it's the first stop during our trip. We'll also drive up the road to Kazimierz Dolny, one of the most iconic Polish towns.
We are going to show you how to do a weekend getaway where you too can find all these incredible flavors. So join us. Mwah! While walking along the picturesque streets of old Lublin, you might get the feeling that time has just stopped. Colorful houses, richly decorated churches, and the medieval royal castle sends us straight back to the times when Lublin was a favorite residence of kings who ruled over Poland and Lithuania. The 16th century Jewish community of Lublin was well known and admired for its richness and high level of sophistication. The city was an important center of Torah and Talmud studies, and it was famous for its Jewish printing houses. Lublin was also a city where the meetings of the Council of Four Lands were held. It was a Jewish administrative institution that covered all the historic lands of Poland. Eventually, the district located at the bottom of Lublin was destroyed. At first, it was heavily damaged during World War II and never fully restored or reconstructed afterwards. There are still, though, some traces of this glorious past of Jewish Lublin to be found in the modern city.
Oh, Mary, yeah? Look. Here is the historic marker of Maharshal Synagogue, the Great Synagogue of Lublin. I think this can give us some perspective of how it looked like.
Wow, this is incredible. And you know that this is not the only learning center that was famous here in Lublin. In the 1930s, they had built a yeshiva. And then, and even today, it's the pride of the Jewish community.
I heard that the building is still there and mm-hmm. we can go and see it.
Okay.
And actually, they have a restaurant where we can dine in.
Oh, well, good. I'm hungry to learn about the yeshiva and I'm hungry to check out their restaurant. Radzio, I'm really, really grateful that you and I could come to such a special place. This yeshiva has been here for so many years before the war. And what makes it even more special, even though it's been renovated, of course, you know, after the war, is that people can come from around the world, especially people from the Orthodox community, and they can see what this Jewish life was like, in a sense, before the war. So it's a very, very special place. I really love this place because it has a lot of different options besides this fine restaurant. This has the yeshiva, synagogue, and hotel, like multifunctional for anybody in the Jewish community that would like to come and visit Lublin. And they have an incredible menu as well. I also found out that they have a kosher menu, but you gotta order in advance. Speaking of ordering, what are you gonna get today?
I'm wondering if I'm going to have marinated salmon and maybe some dessert like traditional Jewish Pascha.
Oh my gosh, that sounds so good. I saw a soup here that has matzo balls, and I think that is what I'm going to get. Also, I have a request. You know, Lublin is very famous for a particular baked good, and I was hoping that we can get it because it's not here on this menu, so we'd have to go to the old town to find it. Would that be okay with you?
Of course.
Okay, so after this, let's go.
Thank you so much, Radzio. I really wanted to get cebularz so bad. This is the reason why you come to Lublin. And cebularz basically is onion bread. Come on. You've got onions, you've got poppy seeds, and basic Ashkenazi ingredients. Come on. And it was cheap eats back in the day.
But I wonder if these cebularz have something in common with the food that people ate here in Lublin before the war.
Well, that's a very good question. By chance, do you happen to know anybody in Lublin that we can get some advice on that?
I think that at Grodzka Gate, there is an expert who could tell us a story about cebularz.
Okay, so can we go?
I think we should find him here in Lublin, so just follow me.
Okay, but wait, let's eat.
Hi, good to see you.
Good to see you too. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
Hi.
Nice to meet you.
Mary, this is Piotr. Piotr is an educator of the Grodzka Gate and NN Theater, which is a place in Lublin when you can learn everything about the Jewish history, pre-war history here in Lublin.
Oh my gosh, I'm so excited to be here.
I'm also excited, but it's cold, so let's go inside.
Oh yes, good idea.
Yes, let's visit.
Thanks.
Piotr, thank you so much for this extremely interesting tour of Grodzka Gate. Can you please tell us something, some story about cebularz?
Cebularz for sure has some Jewish roots. It's a popular pastry here in Lublin. However, rather than being an original Jewish baking from Lublin or Lublin area, It is something that was reimagined or reinterpreted after the war by non-Jewish bakers. And cebularz in Lublin was actually first baked in 1944, in December of 1944, just before Christmas, by Włodzimierz Kuźmiuk, who was a baker born before the war. And after the war, he bought a bakery, an old Jewish bakery in Furmańska Street, and started making pastries that were inspired by something that was called pletzel and was quite similar, I think, in tastes. It was probably different in shape because today cebularz is round and pletzel was probably square.
Yeah, I was wondering if pletzel and cebularz were like cousins because they are almost identical. So that makes sense. I see that connection.
Pletzel is like ancestor of cebularz.
Aha. Okay. So now you know. All right. And I have a question. Lublin is very famous, of course, in a lot of communities in U.S. because people immigrated from Lublin to U.S., Canada, and so forth, and they brought their recipes with them. And I'm wondering, do you know any classic recipes from before the war? Do you have any records of those?
Well, from what I understand, something that was very unique to Lublin was pickled apples. I'm not sure how they tasted. Nobody makes them anymore in Lublin.
Okay.
However, from what I understand, they were quite unique. They were also baking things like bubelech, which were small cakes made of buckwheat with potato fillings.
Oh, that sounds kind of rich. But was this like a street food thing, or was
it
thing
was,
you had at home?
It was street food. It was something very inexpensive, made of inexpensive ingredients as well.
Do we still have those here in Lublin?
Unfortunately, no.
Okay, I think that could be a business opportunity for someone.
Yes, maybe you should start it.
I think that's doable.
Definitely, but I'm already getting hungry,
You should definitely go to Furmańska Street, to the bakery owned by Kuźmiuk family, who were the first one who introduced cebularz after the war.
Thank you. lasagna. Lasagna. Ah. That baking process was incredible, Radzio.
Yes, it seems to me that now we know everything about your favorite Lublin snack.
Yes, all my questions were answered, thankfully.
Yeah. And the conversation we had with Piotr reminded me about the local legend about one of the most famous Polish kings, Kazimierz the Great.
Okay, okay.
Yeah, he fell in love with a Jewish woman called Esther.
Oh, I know this story, but keep going, keep going.
Well, she baked for him something like this.
Uh-huh, because the way to a man's heart is through the stomach. Okay, and by the way, do you know that her castle is not very far from Lublin?
Yes, it's in Bohotnica.
Oh, can we go?
We can do it tomorrow.
Okay, that sounds great. And also, did you know that King Kazimierz had his castle not very far away? And supposedly there was a tunnel connecting both of these castles? So romantic.
It's so interesting. We need to explore it tomorrow.
Absolutely.
According to the earliest versions of the legend I spoke about, this royal romance between Esther, or Esterka, as she is known in Polish, and King Kazimierz the Great paved the way for Jewish people to live in Poland and also for them to receive exceptional privileges. Sadly, though, historians disapprove this romantic story. Apparently, they say there wasn't a Jewish lady who baked onion bread and won the heart of this great Polish king. Oh, regardless, there are still good reasons to visit Bohotnica and the neighboring Kazimierz Dolny. The Jewish community of Kazimierz Dolny was one of the oldest in Poland. It was originated in the 14th century. During the interwar period of the 1920s and 30s, its picturesque landscape, historic architecture, and the unique atmosphere attracted crowds of vacationers, photographers, painters, and writers. Kazimierz Dolny, or as it's known, Kazimierz on the Wisła, and its Jewish houses, shops, synagogues, and vivid market were even used as a location for popular black and white Yiddish films such as Die Bück.
Mary, it was absolutely wonderful idea to come to Kazimierz. This view is absolutely stunning.
Yes, I loved finding the historic Jewish places and the Jewish restaurant options they have available here. But there is still one more place we have to go to really complete this tour of this region. And it is back in Lublin. And it is like the hallmark restaurant. If you come to Lublin, you must try it because they have like Jewish food, but like in a modern Polish way. It's a must. So can we go?
It sounds great. We need to go there.
Okay, so let's go. Radzio, this indeed was a great place, a great choice to end our food tour tonight.
We are hiking a lot, Mary, today. So what are you in the mood for?
I'm in the mood for Jewish penicillin. Do you know what Jewish penicillin
is? No, what is it?
It is a family fancy name that a lot of families call matzo ball soup. And I have high expectations at this place. What about you?
I'm going to have pierogis. Dumplings with some herbs and garlic.
Okay.
And I think I'm going to have a salmon salad as well.
Ooh, that sounds super nice. I'm going to tag on also this chicken schnitzel. It comes with potatoes and salad. That's all for me tonight.
Great. Let's order.
Let's go for it. Do zobaczenia.